Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Saying together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God,
heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father,
Lord God,
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Most High.
You alone are the Most High.
Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
Friends, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house, from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until the morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son? He said, here I am. Eli said, what was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you. So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, it is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
The psalm appointed for today is a portion of Psalm 139, and we'll say that responsively by whole verse. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my journeys and my resting places, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips. But you, O Lord, know it altogether.
You press upon me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it.
For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it well.
My body was not hidden from me while I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. They were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them.
How deep I find your thoughts, O God. How great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand. To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth. Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said to him, come and see. When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael asked him, where did you get to know me? Jesus answered, I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you. Nathanael replied, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered, do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. In his autobiography, Martin Luther King Jr. wrote about a come to Jesus night he had. He had found himself pacing his kitchen floor, fearful, scared for the safety of his family, questioning internally just how much further he could go, how much further he could push, how much longer he could fight the good fight. He said his stomach was churning, and at midnight, he wrote, I prayed these words. I am here taking a stand for what I believe is right, but now I'm afraid. The people are looking to me for leadership, and if I stand before them without strength and courage, they too will falter. I am at the end of my powers, he wrote. I have nothing left. I've come to the point where I cannot face it alone. We might say it was a dark time for Martin, a difficult time for him and the movement that he had reluctantly become the figurehead for. And if it were a story in scripture, it might have been introduced as in the time of King Herod, or like our first reading today from 1 Samuel, in a time when the word of the Lord was rare, visions not widespread, though on life support, the lamp of God had not yet gone out. And then he continued. He said, at that moment, you see, Dr. King had an epiphany that night, a moment when God revealed God's self to him and gave him the strength to reveal it to others. He said, at that moment, in this epiphany, I experienced the presence of the divine as I had never experienced God before. I think to hear Martin Luther King Jr. say that, it must have been a fairly profound moment. I feel like he was pretty aware of and had many experiences of the divine. He said, I experienced the presence of the divine as I'd never experienced God before. It seemed as though I could hear the quiet assurance of an inner voice saying, stand up for justice, stand up for truth, and God will be at your side forever. Almost at once, he wrote, my fears began to go, my uncertainty disappeared, and I was ready to face anything. Friends, I don't think that I am the only one here when I say that personally, I feel like I am experiencing Herodian time. Herodian time. Time when my faith in humanity is waning at best. Time when I'm convinced quite often that visions and epiphanies from God are not widespread. I feel like the author of many of those wonderful psalms of lament, you know, the ones when the psalmist cries out to God, where did you go? What do we do now? And don't forget us, Lord, for we cannot do this alone. Friends, our world seems to have gone mad. In the midst of the daily loss of human life, on a magnitude that just a year ago was beyond unimaginable. And I do want you to stop and think for just a moment. So we're in the third week of January 2021. Just close your eyes for a second and imagine, picture where you might have been on the third week of January in 2020. Might have been here, might have been in another church, might have been sitting at a kitchen table with a paper and a cup of coffee, wherever you might have been at that time. I want you to imagine it, and then imagine if I showed up in your kitchen or here at church and said, in a year's time, we will have lost almost 400,000 members of this country to a virus. We don't go anywhere without masks. We won't be meeting in church, or if we do, it's not going to be the same. If I came in and told you all of these things, would you have believed me? What if I went in and told you that just recently, or in a year's time, men and women would break into our nation's capital, erect nooses outside, carry the Confederate flag through the halls of government, beat police officers, and occasionally stop for a good selfie along the way? Would you believe me when I told you that? And all around our nation, friends, pundits, journalists, historians, and others are arguing over a phrase. They're arguing over the phrase being used again and again that says, we are better than this. America is better than this. Have you heard that one? If you've been watching the news or reading the news or really just talking to your neighbor, I'm guessing you've heard this. We are better than this. And people are arguing and saying, no, we aren't, really. And in some ways, we never have been. This has always been us, or at least part of us. The veneer's just been stripped away, and our roots are now showing for the whole world to see. And I wonder, in the midst of this, friends, I wonder to myself often, where is our Martin? Where is our Desmond? I'd take a Dorothy Day at this point. Where is our Nelson Mandela? Where is our Abraham Heschel? Someone who will rise up from the stink and decay of all that is happening right now and remind us who we're supposed to be. And then I think of Martin. 50-some years ago, pacing in his kitchen, he was no stranger to violence. He was born black in America in 1929. Fear was as natural to him as breathing. He'd been beaten and jailed plenty of times for his marches and his sit-ins. He and his family, his church and his friends, they'd all been threatened countless times. And then on the night that he reached this tipping point, fear and fatigue finally got the upper hand. And Martin Luther King Jr.'s lamp almost went out. Now, friends, I have absolutely no idea what kind of fear and fatigue he must have felt. Because unlike Martin, I was born into a family, into a life, into a community where we could say things like, this is not America, we are better than this, and believe it. I have that privilege. I was born into a life where the scales of justice always dip in my favor. My life has not been perfect, to be sure, but as I reflect on our world right now, on Martin's life then, on the unmasking of white supremacy stitched into the fabric of our country, on the glaring reality that we are not really all treated equally under the law, my not perfect life looks like a fairy tale. And then I begin to feel like old Eli in today's first reading. Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim, lying down in his room, hoping, fingers crossed, God might not have caught the fact that he had turned a blind eye to all of the wretched things that his sons, also priests, had done while he turned and looked the other way. Eli, who knew God, who loved God, who worshiped God, who preached God, but had chosen stability and ease of living over the uncomfortable task of uncovering and rooting out the sins of his sons and the damage they had done to the people's trust in God and God's church. Now, I don't know where you are right now, but this is how I feel. I feel like God has started calling a name, and this time, it's not mine. Because I've failed to listen. I've failed to see. I've failed to follow. Yes, I know that I, too, that I was marvelously made, knit together in my mother's womb by a loving and all-knowing God. It's my favorite psalm in the entire Psalter, friends. I know this with every inch of my body. I know, too, that every other human being was also marvelously made, loved and beheld by the same God. And yet, I also know that I have not followed Jesus into the gutters, into the prisons, into the leper colonies, into the ghettos, into other people's fear and worry of injustice. I have not followed his call in the song of young Mary to honor the truth that all are beloved by God, by helping topple those unjust systems, by feeling hungry with good things, and sending the rich empty away. What good, I wonder, is believing if I'm not acting? Instead, I find myself wondering, who's going to stand up for us? Who's going to lead the charge? I'm waiting for somebody to do it. It's like Eli sending a message to God. God, it's not me. I've failed. Try Samuel just down the way. It's apathy. That's what it is. It's what Jesus called people out of. It's what Martin struggled against. And it's what doomed poor Eli. Apathy. It's easy to love, and it's easy to say nice things. It's easy to blow smoke and say that we're better than that. We're better than what we've all been watching on repeat these last few days. It's easy to apply the beautiful truths of God found in Psalm 139 and then not take responsibility for our roles in a system that systemically oppresses hundreds and thousands of Americans every day just because of their race, their education, or their economic status. The hard part is not loving. The hard part is moving past the fear, past the inertia, past the apathy that we get caught up in and into action. Now, I know that this is not the sermon that most of you probably expected. At St. David's, we strive to be a parish church, not a partisan one. We're not a Republican church. We're not a Democratic church. We're not a social issue church. We are a parish church where we hope and pray that every human being, no matter what their color, their denomination, their gender, age, sexual status, income level, or sense of fashion, we don't care, whoever you are, we want everyone who walks into these doors to feel welcome because it's God's church, it's God's table, not ours. Our sermons are specifically nonpartisan, especially in a town where politics never sleep. We try to keep politics out of them as much as possible, all the while knowing fully that Jesus and his gospel were totally political. It's a thin line. It's a thin line. But we do our best. We cannot, however, separate faith and law. We cannot separate gospel and justice. We cannot separate God and God's people. And that is what I fear we have done for so many generations, that God's call to us, our baptismal vows, are often now disconnected from our public personas, from who we are at work, from who we are in our community, from who we are in our bank accounts, from who we are in our friendships, sometimes who we are even in our families. Justice and love have been torn asunder, separated, and many of us live our lives
in the sole domain of one and only have a casual acquaintance with the other. And friends, we cannot be the church. We cannot be the church. We cannot be the body of Christ if we are not consumed by both. We cannot call ourselves Christian, as many who stormed the Capitol last week do, and only love or seek justice for those we agree with or those who we think are deserving. Never forget, said Dr. Cornel West, never forget that justice is what love looks like in public. And say that again. Justice is what love looks like in public. To love God, we must love humanity. To love humanity, we must address the conditions in which we live. The dignity of human beings matters. Structures and institutions, they matter. Justice is what love looks like in public. And it was this idea, this holy connection between love and power, love and justice, that Dr. King had in mind when he wrote later in his autobiography. He said, "One of the greatest problems of history is that the concepts of love and power are usually contrasted as polar opposites. Love is identified with a resignation of power, and power with a denial of love. What is needed is a realization that power without love is reckless and abusive, and that love without power is sentimental and anemic, dare we say apathetic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice at its best is love correcting everything that stands against love." Friends, we heard today of Samuel's epiphany and call from God. We heard of King David's epiphany put to beautiful verse in our psalm. We heard Nathaniel's epiphany that not only can something good come out of Nazareth, but the Son of God, the King of Israel. And we heard young Martin's epiphany in his kitchen while pacing and praying to God. May each of us, if we aren't already, start praying for the courage to act. For this is not the time to wait and see if a new prophet will rise up and guide us out of these dark days, but for each of us to realize that the job belongs to all of us collectively. Justice is God's love, embodied by us, God's marvelously made children. Amen.
If you would please stand in body or spirit, and let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer, in body, mind, or spirit. Remembering especially today Carol, Bob, Aaron, and Jonathan, and Paul. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed,
by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
Good morning, everyone. Please be seated. Welcome to St. David's on this second Sunday after the Epiphany. For those of you who are here and in person, this, I think, is your first experience at this second service on Sunday. With all of our taping paraphernalia, something went wonky during the first service with our live stream, so Joel is taping again, so a warm welcome to all of those of you who are joining us from home. We're so glad to have you worshiping alongside us today. A couple of quick Kind of quick announcements. One, those of you who are here, you walked by and saw the sandwich collection happening outside. Those of you who may be watching this at home and for just all of a sudden remember that we are collecting sandwiches so others might eat, fear not. There's still time. They will be here collecting for another couple of hours. You still have time to run home, make some sandwiches, or go to Safeway and get some apples or oranges, whatever you might want to bring to help our hungry brothers and sisters in this city. And we are thankful and grateful to all of those in this parish and in the community who have been just doing a phenomenal job of collecting and helping with food scarcity over these last few months. We will be joining other churches, other organizations, and households around the country this week in a national remembrance for all of the almost now 400,000 men, women, and children in the U.S. who have died of COVID-19. That is Tuesday, the 19th in the evening. St. David's bells will ring in honor of the lives lost and in hope, really, a lot of hope that we will soon see a marked decline in both illness and death. But we encourage you either to join in ringing whatever you might have on hand, but I know lots of people are also going to turn on all of their lights in their homes and put candles outside as a witness to this. We'll have more information on the website on Monday, so you can join us. Also know that we will be here at St. David's on Wednesday for our regularly scheduled outdoor noonday prayer service. We understand if many of you want or need to stay home on Wednesday and avoid road closures and other ridiculousness, but come if you can, and wherever you are, do join us in prayer for a peaceful transition of power and healing for our divided nation. Later today at 2:00, we will be having our second online town hall meeting to talk about sacred ground. We had our first this past Thursday night. It was a great conversation with people who are interested in learning more about sacred ground and whether or not they want to join. Please do know that the 2 p.m. Zoom is there for all, so if you'd like to join us and learn more about what sacred ground is, the program, and what it entails, please let us know. For those of you for whom this is new, Sacred Ground is a great and large program that was rolled out nationally a few years ago in the Episcopal Church, and it's a dialogue around race and racism, and really created for white people in white churches to do our own figuring out of who are we, because we too are people of race, right? And so to do that good groundwork. I also want to note that there are people joining us in this conversation who aren't in DC, who are abroad. In fact, my own daughter, who's in Lexington, Virginia, may try to join us as well because it's something that she's interested. So if you know of people, you have family, it's all online, so they don't have to be here in the DC area to join us. If anyone wants to join, they are most welcome. Last but not least, we are rolling out confirmation and reception classes next month. So if you or anyone beloved to you has not been confirmed, wants to be confirmed, or wants to be received in the Episcopal Church from another denomination, please do let us know, and we will get you started on that. A big thank you to Catherine Dubas at the organ. Rothchurch is away again, not so much for vacation, but because his house is right in the middle of downtown DC, and everything's been locked up for days, so he just decided, like a smart man, to get out of Dodge, and he did. I wish for all of you, especially this coming week, friends, health and safety, but also just a lot of love and hope. I do feel that we may be shifting. So many of you have told me that you've gotten vaccinations, and I'm hopeful, so I hope you'll join me in being hopeful. And now, friends, let us join together at God's table. It is God's table, not ours. All are welcome. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and for the sake of love gave everything.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of the glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we have fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Behold what you are. Become what you receive. Body. Let us pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon each of you and those beloved to you this day and always. Amen.
Go in love and to us, go in love to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.